Hey now, I always start on time. What gives, huh? Come on. You guys gotta get out of your mind. You must be on some other clock. I always start the time at 7:30 and there's 5 minute countdown to give some people some time to get in here in case they're late because we all know some other people, not me, are late. And there's only been a couple of times that I haven't been right on the dot, but I'm pretty much on the dot, bros. Anyway, yes, it is Monday night, and I am finally back to normal. Pretty much all day today, I was good. Felt pretty normal, and even went for a run on Monday, so it was nice. And right before we got started here live, I had the kind of a FaceTime call, which the app that we use here, or that they use in Korea, that I think is the best app. I don't know why more people don't use it in the United States, because WhatsApp is like the worst fucking app where you have to give your phone number for it to work. It's so stupid. KakaoTalk is like the best app for messaging and sharing and stuff like that. So we use KakaoTalk, and there's this like live thing that you can do through KakaoTalk through Wi-Fi, so you don't have to like actually pay for anything, of course. I think all the apps do that now. And we were on Kakao with my family in Korea, my Korean family, for about 5-10 minutes. Because over there right now is like their equivalent to American Thanksgiving. It's called Chuseok. And you basically get like 4 or 5 days off of school or work, which is nice. But it always happens at the beginning. I don't like the timing of it. At least it's also weird in Korea because they are opposite of the United States. So like the beginning of their year starts in March, if you're a university, starts in March, and your graduation is like your last semester or your whatever ends in December, like right before Christmas. Whereas in the United States, your first semester is the fall, and then the spring is your second semester, and you graduate in the summer. And that's just not the way it is there. And it's the same thing with this. It's like there, so you're starting school. I always remember we would start school, and then like a week after we'd start school, we'd have a week off. It was like so weird. but I like it more in the United States, Thanksgiving, because at least you're in school for like 2 months and then you get to have a nice week break. It kind of sucks for me. I kind of like my life motto has always been plan for the worst, hope for the best. And that plays out in a lot of things for me. It's like I like to work hard now so that I can rest later. So procrastination is something I just never do. And it's the same thing with vacation. It's like, I would rather kind of like work hard and then have a vacation than to start, have a vacation and then have to work hard the rest of the semester. That's just me though. So anyway, we got to talk to them, and they have a traditional kind of Chuseok thing that they do there. And they like put food around this kind of banner thing, and then they bow, do the Buddha bow, but a couple of them in the family are Christian, so they don't do the bowing, because that would be wrong. But it's always interesting, and it was great to talk to them and get to see them again, and hopefully, now that I'm fully vaxxed, I won't have any problems going in June, July, basically July, to go visit for 3 weeks, and so I'm looking forward to that. It gives me some hope and some future inspiration to continue on in life, because I love freaking Korea and I can't wait to get there to spend 3 weeks right before August, where it gets way too hot to be in Korea, kind of like here in the United States in the Midwest. So anyway, Michael, to answer that question, there's actually a video that answers those questions, so you have to go look up the Korean ones. Although I don't know if I think one of them got blocked because some retarded Korean blocked it because I used in the background while I answered questions his video of him just walking around recording in 4K, and he thought that that was like creative enough to copyright and gave me a strike for it. Didn't even like say, hey, take it down. He just gave me a strike and it got my video blocked. But I think there's another video on there where I answer all these questions about Korea, so otherwise I'll answer for you later. All right. So we got the typical gang here on a Monday night. Looks like there's 11 people in the chat. And we've got Michael Hoerman's set for you. And as he always does, he's got kind of a solid set list that he kind of sticks to, with a few differences here and there. And tonight's set is no different than that. So let's get to it. He says, like some others, I have a sort of pattern to my set. That's the word I was looking for, pattern. Number one is usually good driving rocking song. You guys can try to take a guess of what that's going to be. Two and three tend to be experiments where I could, you know, we could either go either way and like them or not like them. While number four is another driving heavy song. And then number five, I usually like to end on a mellower or at least slower tune. So keep that in mind as we go through these songs. So what better way to start with a good driving rocking song than by Rush? And to be honest, I'm pretty familiar with Rush, although I don't know this song, which I'm surprised by because I pretty much know a lot of Rush's catalog. This is Driven by Rush. Maybe I do know it again and just don't know the title. That's probably pretty typical. I'm not a huge fan of their later stuff. Test for Echo, you're not a fan of that? But even those albums had stuff I liked, of course. It's kind of like Dream Theater's older stuff. I just wanted to give a nod to the guys that put the rock in prog rock, for sure. Prior to Rush, the prog rock or the prog bands were very keyboardy and lacked any metal tendencies at all. Rush changed that. This song is off test for Echo. Oh, it's off for Test of Echo. Okay, I think I might have heard this then. Which is a meh album for me, true, but had some good stuff on it. Of note in this song is an intro with a hard-to-count meter because it changes a lot. Good. Good driving guitar and Alex Tasteley doing moody, dissonant fills instead of guitar leads per se. Geddy's vocals mellowed and toned down the longer they went on, so I don't think anyone will mind the voice on this one. His bass playing is stellar as usual, and Neil on drums lays down some thoughtful beats to match the guitar. I'm sure he's going to do On the Ride, ding, 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 which he pretty much, the one critique I don't like about Neil is that he uses that same ride pattern in tons of Rush songs, not just one or two, like tons of them. Thought this was a good opening song for the set list. So here we go with Driven. I'm pretty sure I've heard this, but I just don't know the title. Here we go. Yes, I have heard this. Thought I could jam to it again. I remember seeing this Test for Echo tour live, and they had like chickens frying on stage in a wash machine or something. Yeah, I like this song. Driven to a fool's paradise. It's my turn to drive. But it's my turn to drive. Driven to the margin of error. Driven to the edge of control. Driven to the margin of terror. Driven to the edge of a deep dark hole. Driven day and night. I love when Dream Theater does like clearly wink winks to Rush in a lot of their songs. And I think the bass parts that Geddy plays under singing are some of the most underrated bass parts. But it's my turn to drive. I don't think I have this on a playlist. Driven to the edge of control. And I like the main track for this album, Test for Echo. I think it's good too. That offbeat on that bell. I like how this is dragging. That's one thing I liked about this song is how it drags. Feels like it drags.
But it's my turn to drive. The road unwinds toward me. What was there is gone. The road unwinds before me, and I go riding on. It's my
JBB. Yeah, that's kind of a sinful thing to say in Prague in general, not just Canada. You might be kicked out of Prague rock too. All right. Yes, I've heard that song several times. Didn't know it by name, of course, which is not pretty unusual. I mean, there's even some Dream Theater stuff songs that I don't know the titles to, or it takes me a minute to think about because I forget them. the only thing I would disagree with as far... Whoa, what just happened? Okay. Focus. There we go. The only thing I would disagree with, one of the things you said was... And I wouldn't necessarily disagree with it. I just would maybe put a different nuance on it. When you said that they brought the like heavy part of rock, I guess for the time, I guess it would be considered more heavy, but I don't see them as heavy at all. I see them as very proggy and much more melodic with some grungier chords, I guess. But to me, real metal was brought into Prague by Dream Theater. I think that's what kind of sets Dream Theater apart is like, even on their first albums, were very metal prog influenced. I see this more as way on the proggy side, more and melodic side than on the heavier side. Yeah, for maybe at the time, I guess, but like in the true sense of metal being enmeshed with like prog, I see that as total Dream Theater's get. That's like what I think brought them to. Remember, we were in the discussion. What's the difference between why people like Symphony X maybe less than Dream Theater overall? I think one of the reasons is because Dream Theater is kind of like the poster boys for like that metal slash prog mesh kind of writing style that was really kind of unique at the time. So, yeah, love that song. I actually like a lot of the songs from that album. Not all of them, but I would agree that the later stuff is not going to stand up to Moving Pictures in 2012 and stuff like that. It's just not going to happen. But can you say that about any band? Speaking of, it popped up on my thing in YouTube. Metallica was on, like, Howard Stern or something like that with Miley Cyrus singing a couple of their songs. And Elton John did an interview about how amazing, not Sad But True, but was it Unforgiven? Like, he was talking about how beautiful it was, one of their songs. And I was, I was kind of like, after I watched, was it Anything Else Matters? I can't remember. All I know is, Kirk was struggling. And they're not even hard guitar parts to play in the first place. And he was struggling. It was noticeable that he was struggling. Even in the rest of the band was kind of like, what the fuck is going on with Kirk? And it made me like, yeah, James did almost cry. I remember that. Yes, because, yeah. But I was just shocked and like, here we are ripping on James, you know, at least Dream Theater fans and stuff like that. But think of how, outside of James kind of losing his voice, which to me is way more understandable than someone losing their guitar chops at a certain age. The vocals are very sensitive. But, I mean, you got, like, the rest of the band, like, at still playing incredibly difficult parts at, like, an immense great level. And then you've got, like, these guys who are around the same age, a little bit older. Are they? Are they a little bit older than Dream Theater? I think they're about the same age. And they can't even play, like, the beginning to Nothing Else Matters. It's just, like, it's kind of weird. It was, like, anyway. Whatever it was the one that Elton John basically, like, talks about how it's one of the best songs they've ever done or ever written, that's ever been written in rock. And he's, like, giving this all the praise, where James almost, like, cries. And then they start playing it, and you're like, whoa, Kirk, what is going on, brah? So anyway, I liked that song. Glad you picked it. And yes, I think that would be a good idea, although it might, you know, ruin it if, like, oh no, I just don't think it would ruin. I think if I do know the popular song that you think I might not know, if I know it, we can just all rock out together. It's not like it's just me experiencing it for the first time, but we could all rock out together. That's totally cool with me. I think if you guys want to try that, that's a good idea. All right, let's get to the next song. I'm already talking too much. Experiments in Mass Appeal is the name of this song by the band Frost with the asterisk. I like this band. I have liked a lot of the stuff by this band. It's so weird now because of the fact that there's two of them. It's hard for me to remember, like, and I get mixed up sometimes, but I definitely know the one with the asterisk, as of late, I've liked their songs. Off the album of the same name, it's a moody piece that takes you through several transitions from quiet to loud. They sort of play with your emotions too, as some of the building leads nowhere and some loud sections happen suddenly. Okay. So maybe not the best transitions is what you're trying to say. I like the unpredictability of the song. So cool. Let's listen to Experiments in Mass Appeal by Frost. Here we go, baby. What up, Gabriel? Sweet. Like the start for sure, and I like that, like, kind of staccato straight bass part with the difference. Into this, like, you feel it's gonna get heavy, but it's, like, slowly building to that. Effect on his voice. There's a band called PFR, Pray for Rain. They're a Christian band that I used to listen to when I was a Christian, that has a couple of songs that have this effect on the voice, and it sounds really good. Good recall back to this first part again. Okay. I see what you just said, Michael. That transition was good, even though it was abrupt. I think because that guitar part that subtly, like, foreshadowed it. Oh, great switch there. Dude, these guys are very talented at songwriting. Yes, JBB, it's a perfect way. Like underwater, yes. Or like a faded radio station. Yeah, these buildings are good. Ryan, just as long as it's not Creed. Because not only have I heard that a billion times, I've played it a billion times on drums. Ooh, that was a great transition. Nice and abrupt. But I totally get what you were saying, Michael. I really dig this song. It's not like taking off, but it is, yeah, abrupt back and forth, but I dig it. Great harmonies here. It's good, JBB. You need some of that startling. Good building here. Man, these guys are really good at writing a song. Totally hear like different voice parts that could be added. That'd be cool. Sounds like it's coming to an end. It's gonna go. Yeah, I thought it would go, which it did. I will say the drumming end there was kind of lackluster, but the was good. The drums could have been a lot. The way it ended on the drums was lackluster. That's the only bad critique I have of that, and it was so small it doesn't matter. That song was very well done. Totally get the description and how you placed it, Michael. I think that was right on. I was worried about those transitions being too abrupt, but I mean, if it shocks JBB, yeah, that's a good thing. All right, so let's get to the next song. Interesting enough, this is a guy that you all should know, but on his own, we probably don't know that very well, and I've only listened to him one other time by himself. And that is the great Richard Henshaw, the guitarist for Haken. Silken Chains is the name of the song. This is off the solo album Cocoons by Haken guitarist. I think the last song we heard was by Cocoons, or off of Cocoons as well. And songwriter Richard Henshaw. You can hear some Haken influence, but at the same time, there's a very different, refreshing sound to all of it for me. It's a bit of a moody piece that is unlike a lot of stuff I listen to. Reminds me of a bit of Alan Holdsworth, great, at times. Peter Gabriel at other times, yes. But despite that, it feels very different. Nice guitar lead with a somewhat clean sound, as much of the song has. Interesting. And Richard can fucking bang on the guitar, so it's nice to hear, like, when they don't necessarily bang. And maybe he does for a second, but it sounds like this is going to be more of like a chill piece by him. Moody piece. So here we go with Silken Chains by Richard Henshaw, baby. Oh, a little heavier than I thought. In a chill piece. Definitely love it. I love the distinction between the hi-hat and then just like the basic dun dun dun. I love when they subdivide shit like that to kind of round out the feeling of a song. Definitely has an 80s vibe with that. The transition for me was a little odd. Could have been smoother. Even like a into that. Versus just like a stop. Lucidly dreaming of the lunar room in the sky. But do you like this part? Yeah, this sounds very Haken-ish. I like it. Yeah, it's totally Haken right here. That was a good switch. I almost feel like this is I Can Feel It in the Air Tonight vibe. Right. I feel like this is kind of mesmerizing me a little bit and making me sleepy in a good way. It's just kind of making me like... like that scene in Dazed and Confused at the end when he just gets home after that crazy situation of the whole movie and he just puts on his earmuffs and he's just like... shave your face off. Jazz album on crack. You have to be on crack to come up with that. That's a good analogy. Ooh, I like it. It might be. Wiener. Yes, Master Manoob, I can see that. A little bit of Pliny with like a less like electric guitar sound. I said wiener, I didn't say that's wiener. Better yet, I should say what my dad used to say, tallywhacker. This is definitely a chill, like... it's kind of lulling me to sleep a little bit. I personally like Tallywhacker. Dad, like, put your tallywhacker back in your pants. Speaking of tallywhackers, that image in the front, the cocoon, looks like a tallywhacker. It's very phallic in nature. Does it look like it in the top? It looks like the dickhead, the mushroom. I like this, but I do feel like it's kind of, I don't know, for some reason, I feel like this is not going anywhere. It lost me about a minute and a half ago. Like, when I started feeling sleepy, I was like, oh, this is nice. And then I just started getting, like, less and less into it. Yeah, Michael, I'd be interested to hear your rebuttal to this, because it seems like a lot of people are having the same feeling, which is it started out strong, but I think it didn't go anywhere and it meandered a little bit too much. So it made it a little too long. Well, I'm guessing this was like 6 minutes, 7 minutes, somewhere around there. So I'd be interested, like, what is it about the song? I mean, I know, I think probably what you said in the thing, it's kind of chill, relaxing, but, like, I do like the kind of a little bit of abrupt changes here and there, but, like, I don't know. It just felt like it didn't go anywhere. It felt like something was just off about it. But I definitely understand the moodiness of it. So yeah, that one's kind of a miss for me, I think. Got me a little tired, but you said, I kind of like parts of it. Yes, Adrian, I kind of liked, like I said, the beginning started out very strong for me. Really liked the subdivision of like the, and then like the, dun, dun, dun. Very good subdivision. That always does great things in my eyes and my mind. So, according to Michael, this next one's going to wake me up. So, and it's by none other than Headspace, who I tend to like a lot. Headspace is one of those kind of like outer, maybe 6, 7, 8 type band for me right now, but they're in the top 10. This one's called Die With a Bullet. It says, I usually like a driving, heavy song in my fourth spot, which is why I've usually had Haken there. But someone mentioned this band in a chat, and I checked them out. That's what this fucking channel's for. Yes. This song caught my ear. I feel it drags a bit long at the end. But overall, I think it's a good, got good transitions, good heavy driving guitar, great leads, and the vocals are better on this one than some of the others I heard. I figured it fits the bill for a number 4 song for me. At the same time, it's different and sure to elicit varied responses. Interesting. Or so I think. Reminds me a bit of Haken, which is likely why I liked it. Oh, this is an official video, so since there is a risk of getting blocked, I have this link as a backup. So I can't remember which one I picked, but if I pick the official video, I'll probably filter it. So let's find out. Die With a Bullet by Headspace. Here we go. Nope, I put the whole fucking thing on there. So let's filter it a little bit, just in case. Lumaki. See if we can just do it a little bit. See if that's enough. Yes, definitely waking me up. Audio and video. Fuck. Fuck. Let's hear more. First bit that came out, I was like, I feel like I've heard this before. But I'm like, did I hear it because I put it on here and I heard the first like 10 seconds of it? Is that why I heard, like, I heard it before? I just looked at the thing. Yes. Yeah, I'm pretty sure I've heard this before and I liked it. I want to say about the singer, when I hear him in like the more neo, I don't know, the more power metal stuff that we've heard him in, I think he's in other stuff, right? It's power metal. I don't like his voice as much in that, but when it's with heavier stuff, I think I like it. And when he's not screaming. Interesting, guys, because I think I put, if a video is blocked, I still put it on there in the document thing that we have. So you still should be on there. I'll have to double check why this one wouldn't be on there. Yeah, maybe it's when he's in Threshold. I don't know. I just like his, when I hear his voice, I'm like, uh-oh, is he going power metal sound? Like, whoop! But like, I like his distinct singing and intonation, And I like his voice when he stays in the lower range. I think it's a really clear, good voice. Yes, I do remember this because the solo fucking riffs. Yes, and I remember talking about them trading. Yep. So I remember being like, that's a Dream Theater part. And did I say that? Oh, maybe not. It sounded very Dream Theater. Like a duel. Like here, I like him. It says excellent connection, doesn't say a warning, so I don't know if it was on there enough to get blocked, but it probably will be blocked, is my guess. But I think the audio gets blocked just as much as the video. Or maybe not. I like this, the way he's delivering the lines here. Yes. Best part of the song right here. Yeah, it's like this off-like feel. See? Clear note and sounds good. None of that. America. Yeah, this is a good song. I think the second half of the song is stronger than the first. Fall of America, Michael, Fall of America. Everything but the last, like, there's like a 30-second section in the very last part of the song that's fucking stupid and retarded. But outside of that, great fucking song by them. Yeah, I definitely think... Yeah, I think he just has less vibrato here, and I prefer that. Fall of America! They have a lot of, like, lyrics about destroying the human race, the fall of America. Nice. I'm pretty sure that's going to get blocked, unfortunately, because that fucking warning was up there for quite a while, which means it's going to get blocked because it's on there enough that it's going to get blocked. But I even blocked it out or Luma keyed it from the very beginning. So that's retarded. Yeah, very, very good song. Liked it before, liked it again. I'm going to check to see why that's not on there. I thought I was still putting blocked stuff on there. Maybe it was just so long ago that I didn't do it or forgot it or something. That's unusual for me to forget that. Maybe we didn't get to it. I don't know. But yes, very good song. And don't apologize. Michael, everyone obviously loves that song. So to hear it again together is great. It's absolutely great. All right, so let's get to this last one. We're at 51 minutes today. Finally, did Colin, which by the way, Colin has been absent for like 2 weeks. I'm pretty sure he's on vacation, but he should be back by now. So we need to check in on Colin because he is a huge part of this channel's community. Motherfucker hasn't been around for weeks now, a couple weeks. So he says, finally, Colin, if you're now listening to this later, did you think I would forget about Haken? Tis, Colin. Deathless by Haken. This is off the Visions album and is the song leading into the Visions title track, which you've reviewed in the past. In that song, you speculated the character may have died and gone to heaven. At the time, I didn't agree with that, but after listening to the lyrics of this one, it seems possible now. Wow, that's a first for me. First few bars will tell you why it was not number 4 in the set list. It's slow, relatively mellow, and a bit moody. Vocals are gorgeous, and the rest of the band's approach on this tune is simply not to get in the way of the story. Okay. I ended up liking this song far more than I expected to the first time I listened to it. So here we go with some Deathless by Haken. And you know I love fucking Haken. We're getting right through these Haken songs, and I love it. And then we can do an album kind of tier list for me when it comes to them once I kind of realize which song fits on which album. All right, here we go with some Haken to round out the set. Jappy, I think, doesn't care anymore because Riverside is not the forefront. He was a Riverside or die guy. Oh, sounds like...
Dying heart, visit me in the flesh. Another noose wrapped around my neck.
I never made fun of him. I liked him. I just didn't like him as much as maybe he wanted me to. Starting beautifully.
Nowhere to land. I feel most alive. But life goes on. Don't wait for me. I'm here to stay.
True, Scott.
Sit to my head, deathless blood, suck it out from my neck. No one's gonna miss me when I'm gone.
Man, Ross sounded fantastic right there. I have several of their songs on my playlist. Several. Maybe 5 or 6.
Don't wait for me. I'm here to stay. To the afterlife.
sounds good. Conceiving You. I love Conceiving You. And I'm loving this song automatically going on the playlist. This is beautiful, Haken. Unless it gets all fucking weird with circusy shit, which I don't feel like it's going to. Ooh, that sounds like John Mayon. Harmonic. Dude, that totally sounds like the harmonics from Lifting Shadows.
Kiss my scars, taste them on my breath.
Love that low.
Stealing time from the great suspense. Come judgment day, I one last request.
Good, then I'm gonna like it. It's going on the playlist. Definitely need to do a Haken album tier list now that I'm getting to, like, I've listened to most of it. Like, I'm just gonna, like, list, after I get all the songs from all the albums, or most of them, I'm just gonna list them from album beginning to start, and then just pick the songs I like off of each album and love this. This is beautiful. It is missing the Caligula's horse, rise to the heavens chorus, but you can't have that with, if you're not CH. Froggy but funky frog. Money's very wide. Funky in the ass. Nice bass part here. Beautiful. Hear the subdivisions? You got that dude. And you got there's that subdivision shit I'm talking about. Would this go on the campfire playlist? I don't know. I'm gonna have to think about that. It's close. It's close. Doesn't like explode it. No, it doesn't explode at any point. It might be chill enough to be a campfire song. What do you guys think? Do you think this could be a good campfire song? Which, by the way, it's been hot as shit, and then it's gonna directly go into winter at the end of this week. Fucking like, or maybe just have a spring week or a fall week. Fire fall. Song and just dragging a little bit, but maybe a little too long, but I still like it. Yeah, winter sucks, my noob. But summer isn't much better. Fucking hot. Yeah, I definitely wouldn't like a lot of rain. Too much Michael Myers. That's great, Ryan. I agree. Maybe I'll play it for my Halloween playlist. I think that's it. Yeah, I think you guys talked me out of it. I don't think it's a campfire song. It was kind of leaning that way already, but I think you're right. It's not like, I agree that when I think of a campfire song, I think of like the old style, like Eagles and those old songs that everybody knows and knows how to sing around to, and shorter 5-minute songs that are kind of like Jack Johnson kind of stuff. That would be campfire stuff to me. Not so much that necessarily, but that is still going on a playlist for sure. Liked it. It'll be interesting to me when we finally get to, I mean, does anybody know off the top of their head how many more Haken songs I need to listen to kind of finish up or round out most of the albums? Does anybody know that? Because I'd be interested, because I feel like we've listened to quite a bit. I think I've got a bunch of albums complete, and there's only kind of like a handful of songs from maybe some other albums that I haven't heard, but we're kind of getting to the end. If we get to the end of these albums, I definitely am looking forward to doing like a newer Haken fan album tier list, because you guys obviously have your tier lists and you've heard them and know them for a long time, but I just discovered them in the last year or two. So, and didn't really like him as much when I first heard him. I kind of liked him a little bit, but they were kind of like not that impressive to me. And then they just grew on me a lot very quickly, along with Caligula's Horse, who instantly caught my heart and has been there ever since. So yeah, maybe if we can get through some of that Aquarius. I think Aquarius has not been, if I remember correctly, Aquarius has not been sold to me as much as a good album because of my specific taste and how I don't like their weirdness. And I think I've been told, if I remember correctly, in the comments of videos and stuff like that, that Aquarius is kind of like the weird shit. I'm pretty sure I've heard Cells Divide. But yeah, I'm gonna go after this and I'm going to check out that list and see why that Headspace song is not on there. Either way, it's going to be on this one because I'm going to add it right after this to the documents. Drowning in the Flood. Oh my God, that's one of my favorite songs. So if they're like that, fuck hell yeah, I will like Aquarius. But I think I remember a lot of people saying, Captain, you're not going to like Aquarius because it's got weird shit on it. Okay, wasn't it Aquarius? I'm pretty sure that was the album that had the carnival-y, over the top dumb shit. But I don't know. If it's fucking Drowning the Flood, Drowning the Flood is probably my top three songs by them. Falling Back to Earth is so good. Oh my God, there's so many good songs. Anyway, we can't get lost in that. We'll do that when we do the tier list. All right, we're at 1 hour and 4 minutes. Michael, great set. Lots of good songs. Several of them will be going on a playlist for me. And yeah, what we have coming is Thursday. You can already see that there's a set coming from Master Manoob or Manuel Romero. He will be up on Thursday, and then I have to check and see what people have sent after that, and we'll get those situated for this weekend. So you guys all have a good rest of the week until Thursday. We will see you then, and stay thirsty, my friends.